When I was a theological student, I did some work in some of the correctional institutions in the area. And I continued to do some volunteer work after I was ordained in some of those same places. And there was a man that we met there. My wife Shirley used to come in after I was ordained with me, and we would do some Bible studies and so on. We got to know one of these fellows quite well, and in fact, when he was released, he came and lived with us for 6 months, which was an interesting challenge. He had a strange philosophy of life. He believed in God, and he believed God was with him all the time. And he was never happy, because when things were going well, it meant that things would soon not go well, because God kept everything in balance. So if you were having good times, it meant that bad times are coming. So we couldn't enjoy the good times because bad times are coming. And when bad times came, well, they were bad times. So couldn't be happy then either. One day when he was working on his car, he got angry at God for some reason and threw a wrench at God. Whether or not it hit God, we're not sure. But it did come down through the neighbor's front window. So that didn't work out very well for him. Sometime later, a woman who was a friend of ours was telling me about how she had overcome a personal issue that had been a struggle for her for a long time, which was impinging on her health. And she had prayed, and she said it was great because God was doing it. It had nothing to do with her. It was not self-discipline. It was not her own decisions. It was simply God giving her the strength to do what she needed to do to improve her health. But 6 months later, she stopped doing all those things which were good for her health, and she was right back where she was before, only now she was depressed because God had stopped doing those good things for her. So God got all the glory and God got all the blame. So she wasn't happy either. I thought of those two people when I read this passage today from that we had today from 1 Kings, where Elijah comes and helps the woman. And while he's with her, she has the jar of oil and the bowl of flour, don't run out. And it was a miracle. She thought there was enough left for one meal, and yet it was enough to last them 3 years throughout the whole famine until the rain came and brought new life to the world. And yet, when her son fell ill and died, then she blamed that on, indirectly on God. It's interesting the way that was worded. I don't know if you know this, but why have you come to me, she says to Elijah, so that God would know about my sin? Sort of like, I wish God had not noticed me. Right? Yeah. She figured, now that God's looked at her and seen over here, and so what she had received from God seemed to have been taken away. Well, certainly, how can one be happy if one loses a child? A very tragic thing. And Elijah then brought the child back to life. And that was a good thing. Now, there's a difference between that story and the story we had from the Gospel of Luke. There's several differences, but one difference that I think is significant is that in the story from 1 Kings, there are those elements in the story about the woman and whether or not she deserved what she received. Right? God was abandoning her. She was going to die of starvation. God came to her and she could live. God came to her and judged her, and so her child was going to die. God came back and restored her. Whereas in the story of the widow at Nain, when Jesus came and healed, brought back to life the woman's son, There isn't anything in there about whether or not she deserved it. There isn't anything to say, okay, I know you've been bad, but I'll bring your son back anyway, or the reason your son died is because you've been bad. None of that. Now, when you think through the Gospels of the things that Jesus did, there were times, remember the man went down through the roof and he was there, a paralytic, and Jesus starts by, obviously he's brought because he's lame, can't walk, paralyzed, and Jesus says, your sins are forgiven. That's not what I came for. Actually, I'm paralyzed, if you hadn't noticed. No. And Jesus says, your sins are forgiven. Very interesting, that the way that plays out, because then they start grumbling, who's this that thinks he has power to forgive sins? And Jesus says, well, just so you know, I've got power to forgive sins, rise, pick up your bed, and walk. So it's like the healing is secondary to the important thing is the forgiveness of sins. But just in case you didn't get it, I'll do both. And so the man rose up and could walk and take his bed and make his way out of a very crowded house. So for Jesus, you see, one would say that the man shouldn't have been healed because he was a sinful man. It indeed was. I mean, Jesus forgave his sins, so he must have had some sin. Remember John chapter 8, I think it is, the blind man who was born blind from birth, and they said to Jesus, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And Jesus says, neither. This was so that you'd understand the glory of God. And he healed the blind man. So it didn't matter if it was sins or sickness. It didn't matter if they were paralyzed or lame or blind or deaf or unable to speak. It didn't matter. Jesus healed them, forgave them, restored them, opened their eyes, opened their ears, loosened their tongues, brought them back to life. Didn't matter. Didn't matter what it was. Jesus healed them. And that's the power of the grace of God. And I want to think for a moment, just so that we can get this in the right perspective, about the reading today from Galatians, which, if you were able to focus on it, I'm not sure if you got the drift. Because Paul's going on at some length about how, yes, when I saw Jesus and was converted, then I went to Arabia for a while, and I was there for 2 years, and then I was here for a while, for 3 years, and then I didn't see any disciples, and then I was there, and then I finally went to Jerusalem for 2 weeks, saw Peter, only Peter, and nobody else, and then I went back off, and you're thinking, okay, nice story, but like, why are you telling us this? Well, Paul is telling us this because, as you know, he was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. As to the law, faultless, right? He talks about that in his readings. He was a very devout person. But it wasn't good enough for him. Didn't work. He met Jesus on the road to Damascus. And now, he literally saw the light. That's the whole story is about, right? He saw the light. He understood. Before he had been blind, well, now he was blind, and then his eyes were open, and he saw what Jesus was talking about. He understood what the gospel of grace was. He understood more than anybody else that it wasn't all of the things that you do that add up to righteousness, because he'd done all those, and it didn't add up to righteousness. He did not see himself as holy before God, because he had followed all the laws, he'd been meticulous about them all, and still, when confronted with Jesus, he realized that he was a man of sin. And yet, Jesus forgave him, even though none of that other stuff did any good. So here's the thing. The other disciples who had followed Jesus around were ordinary common folk. Peter, James, John, and Andrew were all fisher folk. Matthew was a tax collector. We're not sure what the occupations were of the others, but they were all common Galileans. We heard that on the day of Pentecost, right? Who are these speaking in tongues? Aren't they all Galileans? Like, These are country bumpkins. What do they think they're doing talking in all these languages? So those folks had never lived the life of purity that Paul had lived. They tried, but to be religious, really religious, you have to also be really wealthy, because you didn't have time when you had to work every day to do all of the spiritual exercises. So they'd never gone down that road where Paul had gone, of holiness by one's own attempts. And so they didn't understand the futility of it. So when the early church began, first of all of their converts were Jewish people. So there was no question about you need to become Jewish to become Christian. And then they started finding people who were not Jewish, who wanted to be Christian. And the question was, do you need to be Jewish first to be Christian? Do you need to follow all the laws of Moses to follow, be a follower of Christ? And Paul said, absolutely not. Because, by the way, that doesn't work. I tried it. It doesn't work. So when Paul was confronted with Peter and the other disciples in Jerusalem over the question of whether or not you had to be ritually pure first to become a Christian, Paul stood face to face against him. That's the word he used. I stood face to face against Peter. In fact, if you read it, it says I stood face to face against Cephas, because he used Peter's Hebrew name just to make sure. Look, you're Hebrew. I'm using my name Paul, which is a Roman name. Let's see who's on which side. So all that in Galatians today was a lead up to what comes later, where he's making profoundly the statement, it's by grace that we're saved through faith. Not our own doing. It is a gift from God. Okay, so let's go back now to the healings and the resurrections and all of the gifts that God gave. Let's go back to the wrench going up in the air and going through the window. Let's go back to whether or not if bad things happen, does that mean good things are going to happen? If good things happen, then bad things are going to happen. If we think that all of life is some cosmic balancing act on God, oh, okay, Jeff's had it pretty good for a while, kind of. That's not what God is about. There's Gary Larson cartoon. I remember Gary Larson, the Far Side. He doesn't do it anymore. There's God, and on the computer screen in front of God is a man walking along the street, and there's a grand piano on a rope from a crane, right, coming off the building. And on God's computer keyboard, there's one great big button that says smite. And God's got finger right over the smite key as the man walks underneath the piano. If that's the way we're thinking, we misunderstand it altogether. It's about grace. It's about God's gift. God forgives us not because we deserve it. That's the whole point. God forgives us because we need forgiveness. God forgives us because God chooses to forgive us. God blesses us because God loves us, cares about us. And when did God start loving us? From before the foundation of the world. There's that beautiful passage in the book of Revelation where the Lamb, before the throne comes the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. That is to say, it's God's intent from the very beginning, before creation began, to play out this whole scenario where Christ dies for our sins and forgives us. It's not an afterthought. God's love for us is not, oh, how do I fix this? God's love for us is at the very beginning. Just like when we have children of our own and they start to grow up, we know when they're born they're going to do bad things. We do not want to admit it to ourselves, but we know. No, not my child. My child will be perfect. Okay? We all think that. But we really know there will be hard times and difficult times and troubling times, but we'll love them through it. We'll bring them through it. They'll grow up and everything will be fine. We know that. And so we go ahead anyway and have children and know that God will bless them. God loves each one of us. And the stories of the scripture tell us that God's love is unconditional. God's forgiveness is unconditional. And God does that. Why? So that we'll respond with love. I mean, when we love our children, what do we want in return? Most of all? Well, obedience is kind of nice. But what we really want is for them to love us more than anything else. And even if they do bad things, we still, that's okay if they really love us. It's the love that counts. And that's the way it is with God. So remember we talked about the Ten Commandments. We won't go through the whole Ten Commandments, right? No, earlier, the creation story, that's the one. The creation story. On the sixth day, God created humankind. And it was very good. That's what God thinks of us. God loves us, we're very good, and blesses us. And so we give thanks to God, who is rich in love and mercy.